church. In many ways, it's a privilege to stand up and get to lead worship. And one of the real privileges is getting to see who comes into the balcony on Sunday mornings. You guys can't see that, but we got a particularly good-looking group in the balcony today. It's good to see everybody. Louie, it's good to see you. Good crew in the balcony today. Amen. Welcome to the worship service. Welcome to those in the sanctuary this morning. Welcome to those joining us in the streaming audience. It's going to be a really good service today. Really important message. Diane did a great job last week stepping in for Pastor. We talked about anger last week. Apparently that theme is going to kind of carry through. We're going to talk about another segment of conflict. Maybe others' reactions to our actions. Maybe even our righteous actions, how sometimes people can react to them and how we should react to that. So we'll look forward to Pastor's message. Administrative Council, we have a brief meeting, and I mean brief. If you can get up here real quick, we'll get out of here in 2 minutes. Just administrative, a quick vote we need to do immediately following the service. Nancy is going to come and bring an important announcement about a service opportunity that we have. I want to mention, guys, can I have the parsonage, thermometer, a new graphic that Barb put together for us? We're going to be talking about the parsonage because we have to continue to talk about the parsonage. We're going to talk about the financing of the project until we get it finished, and we're going to do that almost weekly probably to keep people up to speed on where we are. Could be $150,000, probably going to be closer to $100,000. We've got $100,000 already set aside. We need to raise the other money just to make sure that we don't get caught short at the end. So we're going to have some fundraising opportunities, commitment cards, till we can identify that last $50,000. So we're going to keep in front of you that would be the $50,000 percentage. That being said, if there's anyone that would feel led to be involved with communicating to the congregation about the finances, to kind of keep it in front of you, to keep the thermometer up to date, and to do the commitment cards, if you would like to help out with the parsonage committee, please come and see me. We could really use someone to take that on. Nancy, please.
When they come to you 15 minutes before service and say, hey, will you speak? There's nothing like getting toothpaste all over you and then trying to cover it up. Whatever the storm, whatever it takes. We know that there was flooding in Pittsburgh. When Pastor Tim and I were on vacation, there was flooding in Kettle Creek the week before. The campgrounds were closed. And even when we were there, I took pictures of a bridge that when the water came up again. We know that flooding happens in western Pennsylvania. When we were in St. Mary's, the former pastor is on the district missions, and he was actually in Dubois because they had flooded, and they were using the flood buckets that the Western Pennsylvania Conference and others have made. So in your bulletin, there's a white piece of paper, and these are the UMCOR cleaning kit assembly and shipping instructions. It's about $75 per bucket. I shouldn't give a plug, but if you have coupons and go on Saturday to a certain store, you can save $5 off of $25 or $30. So I won't mention any stores. The 5-gallon bucket with a resealable lid, it can be any bucket as long as it didn't have chemicals in it. So if you know someone at the cafeteria who has old pickle buckets, or if you know someone who can donate buckets, that helps you, it helps everyone. Please stay to what these ounces are. They are exactly what fits in a bucket. If you have problems putting everything into the bucket, the youth helped last year, they got everything into the bucket. I can help you put it into the bucket. But there are some things that you should not put in the bucket. These are things that people are going to get, people who have had standing water that need to scrub down walls. It might have been this high, it might have been this high. They just need to clean everything, which is why they say to remove the packaging. They have enough garbage without the plastic on everything that we have. So if you would like to do a bucket, if you'd like to go together with someone for a bucket, or if you find a sale on something and you just are led to buy, you know, 50 clotheslines, you know, we can work with anything that you do. So we are going to do the mission, the buckets. The conference has asked Pastor Tim and all the ministers to do flood buckets, especially after the flooding that was in Pittsburgh and other parts of Western Pennsylvania. If you have any questions, talk to Pastor Tim. He'll send you to me.
Who is that the truth? Ladies, May 11th, a chip and dip day. A chip and dip day for the charcuterie. We learned that word last year. Charcuterie. Wednesday 11th, ladies, if you'd like to get involved with that, see Sue or Chris. And then the Chautauqua Women's event will be coming up in your bulletin in the Thursday blast. Be talking more about that. Okay, announcements. Boom, boom, boom. Christians have a terrible habit of having our own language, and we create words that don't convey a lot of information and confuse people. And we name things oddly. We're in that situation now with something called the Council of Ministries. The Council of Ministries will be meeting tomorrow night. This is going to be one of those days in the church when we look back and say, I remember that day. So much changed because of that day. So we're going to rename getting together for the Council of Ministries. What that is going to be is the heartbeat of our church is meeting tomorrow. Everything that exists at South Harbor Creek, the staff, the facilities, the trustees, the finances, all those things do is go to feed the work that the church does. And tomorrow we're going to identify and help to reorganize the work that we do, work that takes place inside the church, work that takes place outside the church, education, service opportunities. The end game of every Christian, anyone striving to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, is to develop a servant's heart. This is an opportunity to serve, to plug in, to see what ministries are already taking place in a church, maybe where you could serve and help out and plug in. Please pray about it. Please attend. If you have any inkling, you should be here tomorrow night. Be here tomorrow night. There's new energy. There's new focus. And we're done now. We've done enough. We did COVID. We did a pastoral change. We did all this other stuff. Now we got a parsonage. That's behind us. We're going to get that done. We are going back to work as a church. It's time that we go back to doing ministry, and that's 100% of our focus, mission and ministry. So tomorrow night, please come to the Council of Ministries meeting and see where your part is. That sounded like a prayer. Let's keep praying. Father God, you call us to be about your business, Father God. You call us to be kingdom builders. You call us to be on the move, not on the sidelines, in the game, outside of our comfort zone. We trust that you will empower people. You will call people, they will respond, and you will pour into them all they need to do, all that you ask of them. We merely need to show up. Help us tomorrow night as our church begins again in a fresh way to do the work that you have for us. We trust the Holy Spirit is out before that meeting, even now, preparing opportunities for our people to step in and to be Jesus to other people. We give you thanks for this service today, Father God. We give you thanks for our pastor as he comes to bring a good word. Prepare us to receive it. This time is yours. We adore you, Lord, and we give you thanks and praise. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Today I will be reading from Acts chapter 4, verses 5 through 12. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas and the high priest was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other of the high priest's families. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who is lame and are being asked of how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead. That is the man that stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become a cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no name under heaven given to a mankind which must be saved." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Constant in the trial. If you're going through anything, just keep saying that. You will never fail. You will never fail this week. I don't know that there's any better reminder of God and who he is. Okay. I'm starting off with the praise this morning. We have, I talked to Jeannie Langdon this morning and her great-granddaughter, Gianna, who we've prayed for years. It turns 14 today? Tomorrow. And she has she had a great report. She's cancer-free. She's doing wonderful. So that's a great, huge praise. We do need to be praying for some in our congregation, a real good friend who's going through cancer treatment. Let's just be praying for every step of that way. You know, when we're listening to songs on Sunday morning, you know, some of them are like prayers. They really are prayers. And so when you're listening to them, this person just kept coming to mind. So we need to be praying for those going through cancer treatment. Now this week, I saw our friend Ruth Heath, who's usually streaming and watching, and she let me know that Ingley Norden passed away. And Ingley was a part of our church for a long time. She played the piano for the kids when they would go to Sunday school, and we had seen her, some of the young girls, we went to Ball Pavilion at Christmas time and sang songs and did crafts and stuff, and she passed away the end of December. So I just wanted to let you all know that she was a delight, and she blessed our congregation when she was here. So I just wanted to let everybody know that. Sandy asked us to be praying for John. He had a procedure this week, and he's in a lot of pain. Marie was kind of filling me in, and I won't go into all the gory details, but he's really not feeling good. And Sandy's really concerned for John. So let's be lifting him up in prayer. And then I know Pastor's going to say something, and she's going to kill me. But Barb's here this morning. And this is her last week, and she's going to the freedom of retirement. So we're excited about that for her. But I was thinking about Barb. We had a luncheon for the staff, took her out to lunch this week. And we invited Pastor Larry to come, because Pastor Larry hired her in 1985. For those of you who think I'm quite elderly, I was 15 years old when Barb started working here. And just, you know, I'm just reminded over and over again that she is the first voice you hear when you call this church. That her, she, you know, the administrative assistant, yeah, she does all that administrative stuff that I really stink at and could never do. But her ministry to South Harbor Creek since 1985 has been such a blessing to us. And I couldn't pass this opportunity without just recognizing that she really has been through all of the things and all the changes in our church. So we just are so happy for you and praying for her. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can come together and that we can worship you, that we can sing your praises, that we can intercede for our friends that are going through cancer treatments, or celebrate for those that are getting good reports. Father, that we can remember dear saints like Ingley, who have made a significant impact on this world and on this church through her love of you. Father, we thank you for Barb this morning, just for the ministry that you have done through her, the prayer ministry, the confidentiality. Boy, that lady knows some secrets. But just how she has held on to that confidentiality that has helped us to confide in her and share things with her over many years. Father, we want to pray a blessing on her. We want to pray a blessing on her husband, Terry, and their family and their grandkids, that this new season for them is not the end of her season of ministry, but just a change in that, and that you will use her to bless whoever comes her way. Father, we want to lift up those in our congregation, our kids, as they're going to start their PSSAs this week. We want to pray for just clear minds and focus that they can do well. We want to pray for our teachers who are needing to be patient through all the testing in these coming weeks. Father, we pray for our seniors, 11 seniors from our church family that are going through the last 6 weeks of school. We pray, Lord, that you would make this a good time for them, a blessed time for them, that you would help them finish strong, that you would keep them safe and protected from bad decisions, that you would just put a hedge of protection around them and bless them as they're going through this fun season. Lord, we pray for just our whole church family, that you would bind us together, that you would knit our hearts together to serve you as the body of Christ at South Harbor Creek. Lord, we love you. We stand in awe of you and your mercy and your grace that you show us every single day. Father, be with us now as we pray together the prayer you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Rest of them. I got pictures to show you. You gotta get closer so you see my face. here they come. Morning. Hey, Lily read from the book of Acts just a few minutes ago. Did you all pay attention? Well, in it, Luke tells the priests and the Sadducees and all those bigwigs of the church that the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Now, anybody know what a cornerstone is? What do you think a cornerstone's made out of? Stone. Where do you think you might find it? On a corner. So look at that. See, you know what they are. Well, today, cornerstones, I think, are more decorative. I was asking Terry Young, because he's laid a lot of cornerstones in his young life. But I think today, cornerstones are more decorative. And he told me even sometimes they put a box inside it with things that are going to be, how would you say it, just memorabilia that maybe 100 years in the future, if somebody will open it up. Well, I have pictures of a cornerstone. Now, for some reason, my printer prints everything in a shade of pink. So there's a cornerstone. See it? You know which one I'm talking about, right? It says 2006, because probably whatever that building is was built in 2006. So it's just kind of pretty. But in the olden days, in Jesus' time, a cornerstone was really more important because it's the first stone they laid, and it had to be perfectly level and perfectly square because all the rest of the stones were laid down in relation to that stone. So here's an old building in Israel that you can see the cornerstones, that big one. You want to pass that around? Pass it back, and if anybody hasn't seen it, you can point it out. So back then, the cornerstone, if they didn't do that one right, the building would be crooked, it wouldn't be square, it wouldn't be very stable. And boy, if you pulled that stone out, the whole building would collapse. So when they said that Jesus was the cornerstone, they meant he's the cornerstone of our church. Without him, our church is nothing. Yes, sir. Well, yeah, but that's because the weather and the time has just made the stone all icky. But it's still doing its job even after all that time. The building's still standing, isn't it? Well, that's the way the cornerstone is for us. Jesus is our cornerstone. Without him, we wouldn't have a church at all, both physically and spiritually. But with Jesus, we're strong, we're believers, we're faithful, we share our love, and that's so important to us. Now, when I was thinking about cornerstones, I can't help it. My mind goes, And I thought of another important stone. It's called a keystone. See that arch right there? Right in the middle of it, that one stone right there is the keystone. In fact, our state is named the Keystone State. Well, that stone is as important as a cornerstone, because if that stone ever came out, the whole arch would collapse. That's what holds it all together. Yeah, it's kind of like the part of a side of a bridge. So that stone is also very important, but I don't think they use that to refer to Jesus, but we could, couldn't we? Because without that keystone, everything collapses. So we want to remember that our church is formed around the stone called Jesus Christ, and he is the source of all our power, our strength, and our love. So let's say a prayer. Father, keep us always mindful of where our blessings come from, that we would thank our Lord Jesus Christ for all he has done for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand and join Jim and I with the hymn?
Affirmation of our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Gracious and almighty God, we thank you. Thank you for the blessings that you bestow upon us each and every moment of our lives. We ask you now, almighty God, to receive these gifts of thanks and praise. Bless them, multiply them, use them for the ministries you desire them to be used. We ask all this in Jesus' most holy name. Amen. Our New Testament lesson this morning comes from 1 John, the third chapter. And it's often funny when you direct people to 1 John, they turn to John. But 1 John is towards the back of the Bible. 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 to 24, John writes these words. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and truth. This, then, is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. And this is the command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. Those who obey his commands live in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. The word of God for the people of God. This is both a sad and joyous day. It is joyous for Barb. She's finally retiring. After how many years? 39 years. That's more years than most people work in a regular job, much less an administrative assistant at a church. If you get 5 or 6, maybe 8 years out of an administrative assistant at a church, you can talk some smack. But we got 39. 39 years of ministry, as Sue mentioned earlier. And it is sad for us, because we are losing a vital person in our congregation, a person who did not just love with words, but loved with actions. And I know that because I am the recipient of some of that love. I know Barb was ready to retire right before I got here. I also found out that she was going to stick around to see how this new guy was. And I've been blessed to get 2 years out of her. 2 wonderful years. She has guided me through some, navigated me through some crazy times and helped me avoid some pitfalls that, you know, every church has their sacred cows, if you will. And, you know, as a new pastor, you have no clue what those are, so you need someone to kind of guide you. And I am grateful for Barb for showing me and sharing with me what some of those are here at South Harbor Creek. We are blessed this morning that Barb is with us. Barb, would you please stand? It is with our hearts, with all of the love of this room, that we provide you with a little something. And we hope that will help you on your trip that you are planning on taking here in the next couple of weeks or whatever. And everyone here wishes you nothing but the best. You have given your best to us, and we wish that for you as well. May God bless you and keep you. Barb, thank you so much. She told me I wasn't allowed to bring her up here. She told me she wasn't going to give a speech. So, but she did say that she would meet you in the narthex following church if you'd like to say your personal goodbyes. She won't be finished until Friday. So, but I know many of you won't see her till then. It's what we do that matters. It's what we do that matters. Most of us in here remember Princess Diana, right? Anybody here remember Princess Diana? She was labeled as the people's princess, and I think even here in the United States of America, we considered her our princess. I know that sounds weird because we don't subscribe to royalty in this country, but I think there was something about Princess Diana that we all gravitated to. She was a special lady, thrust into a very bizarre world and set of circumstances. She is quoted as saying this, and I quote, "Carry out a random act of kindness with no expectation of reward, safe in the knowledge that someone might do the same for you." I don't think any of us would belittle or begrudge Princess Diana for the good that she did. And you know, we could go on for hours listing all of the good that she did in her rather short lifetime. She, like John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, reached out to the poor. And it's interesting because when John Wesley reached out to the poor, the Church of England kicked him out. He got in trouble for doing good. Diana got in trouble for doing good. The royal family oftentimes was not very happy with her in the way that she would sort of encourage them to reach out to the poor. It was kind of stepping out of their comfort zone. That's not what they believed they were to be there for, but Diana changed all that. Sometimes saying and doing the right thing can be very difficult. Peter and John, let me back up for a second. January 5th, 1997. Many of us will remember that picture of Princess Diana wearing a flak jacket, wearing a helmet with a face shield, walking in a minefield in Angola. Now, that's a pretty hairy situation. But she did that to bring attention to the devastation that minefields were creating, not just in war-torn areas, but in other areas as well. Excuse me. And of course, the royal family was not very happy with her at that time. Peter and John, who Lily read about in Acts, they just healed a lame guy. Now, you would think that that would be a good thing, right? If you came to me and you were sick or you had some disability or whatever, and I was able to heal you in some way, shape, or form, more than likely I would not be ridiculed for that. Probably praised. Unfortunately, I don't have that ability, but Peter and John got in trouble because they healed a man. So the priest and the Pharisees in Acts 4:7 say, "By what power or what name did you do this?" And Peter and John poked the bear, if you will. They replied, "In the name of Jesus." And it was the reason they were able to heal the man. And then they poked them some more. Maybe this is why they really got into trouble. Because they said, "He's the one you killed on the cross." Of course, they didn't want to hear that either. And they were arrested. When I was starting out my career as an inspector, I inspected a lot of restaurants. The restaurant business is an interesting business, and one of the places that I had to inspect was a truck stop that was open 24/7, 365. So, as an inspector, you understand that when you walk into a place that's open 24/7, you're going to find some stuff. If you don't find stuff, you're not looking. I mean, really, you don't even have to look to find stuff in a place that's open 24/7. So I went to inspect this truck stop, and I expected to find certain things, and I did. I found quite a number of things, nothing, however, that would cause it to be fined or to be shut down. They were just a lot of little things that needed to be addressed. Now, that amounted to about 5 pages of report. The owners were not happy. And as we sat down to go over this report, the primary owner was a big guy, big, tall, muscular guy. He was, in fact, in his truck stop, if you went in there, there were mounts all along the wall of antelope and deer, and I think there was a bear, and just all kinds of, you know, just a rugged kind of guy. And he truly was not happy with me at all. So he said to me, "Why don't we settle this out in the parking lot?" Now, I may be tall, relatively tall, but I have never been physically strong. This guy would have crushed me in a matter of 2 seconds. I would have had no defense. But I turned to him and I said, "No, we're not going to do that." I says, "First of all, I'm not going to engage you, and second of all, if something happens to me in act of my duties, that is a federal crime." His tiny little wife reached up and grabbed his arm and set him right back down. And she was tiny, too. She was only about yay high, real sweet petite lady. They were still not happy, and they went and they confronted my boss. And my boss said to them, "Is any of this not accurate?" And they said, "Well, no." then fix it. I told them that I would be back in a month to see if they'd made any progress. So the day comes. My heart is pounding. I was probably, 160 at the time? Scrawny. So I walk into the restaurant, and I'm very nervous. I'm not excited about being there, and all of a sudden, I look up, and here he comes. And I'm thinking, here we go. He comes up to me, and he puts out his hand. So I shook his hand, and all he said was, I want to thank you. In my report, I had placed suggestions on how to correct some of these things and make it easier for everybody. He implemented those suggestions, and his staff loved it. They were working better. They were working more efficiently, so he loved it. Doing the right thing is not always easy, is it? Saying the right thing is not always easy. And sometimes we have to do that. Peter and John did the right thing. They acted appropriately. They even said things that were very difficult for the Pharisees and the Sadducees to hear. And they probably, they ended up in jail for it, essentially. But we as Christians need to say and do the right thing. It is our actions, not our words, that will draw people to Christ. One of the things that I have a tough time with often is when someone comes up to me and says, do you know Jesus? If you don't know Jesus, you're going to hell. It's like, wait, slow down here just a bit. Why don't you be my friend first? Why don't you, share with me your story before you dive in and tell me that I'm going to a horrible place? Mahatma Gandhi was a very interesting character. He was a Hindu, but he almost became a Christian. And it's a crazy story. There he is in Calcutta. And he was looking at the church and he wanted to know Jesus. He really, truly did. And he went to go into a church. And when he got to the church, the person that met him at the door said, sorry, you're not permitted in here. And the only reason was because he was not white. Now, he's not black. He was Hindu. He grew up in India. He said he was turned off by the sin of segregation that was practiced by the church. Do we do that too sometimes? Do our actions convey a message that you are not welcome here? Do our actions send a message that says only certain people are allowed to be a part of Jesus' family? 1 John 3:18 says, dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions in truth. I'm sure that every one of us, myself included, at one time or another has said or done something that certainly conveys a message of that's not Christian. Let me just put it that way. It can be a struggle at times to do the right thing. It can be a struggle when you walk downtown on State Street and you're confronted by a person there asking for change or for a meal. It can be a struggle at times at work when maybe it's just a frustrating day and you're lashing out against whoever happens to be there. It can be a frustrating time when you're at school. And maybe there's that one kid or that one teacher that, you know, nobody seems to connect with. You know you should. But if I do, my friends are going to think I'm not cool. We can tell people all day long that Jesus loves them, but if we don't act like Jesus loves them, if we don't act as if Jesus loves us and wants us to love them, they're not going to receive the message. It's our responsibility and our duty to love through our actions. It's our actions that will invite people in to the family of God. We saw this in the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. You know the parable. Lazarus was a poor beggar, and the rich man had all the food and everything, wouldn't even give him the scraps off his table, and they both die. The rich man, he goes to the depths, and Lazarus is seen in the bosom of Abraham. It wasn't that the rich man was rich. It was that the rich man failed to act in a Christian loving way. We need to take our example from people like Princess Diana, from various others who step out and do good, to encourage, to invite, not to condemn, not to persecute, and not to harm. As the Princess Diana once said, do random acts of kindness without expecting a reward. When we do that, we will invite others to Christ. Let us pray. Almighty God, in our day-to-day lives, we get caught up in ourselves. We get caught up in getting from here to there, from dealing with the struggles that life has to offer, and oftentimes we fail to respond when you call us. Guide each one of us through your Holy Spirit, Lord, to show kindness, to show mercy, to show grace and love every opportunity you give us. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a quick reminder, those of you of the trustees and those of you of the ad board, you both have very, hopefully, very quick meetings following worship here. And if you'll do that real quickly, then you can go out and say your final goodbyes to Barb. Now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord give us the wisdom to answer the call, to meet the needs of those around us, now and forevermore. Amen.